Well, good morning, everyone. Go ahead and stand with us as we sing this first song. Sorry, I just got a catch in my throat right before I started talking. Elsie's Deo means glory to God in the highest. So I pray that we can give glory to God this morning in the midst of everything happening. Let's just lift our hands to Him.
Good morning. Good morning.
Good morning.
Well, thanks for braving the ice and the snow. We were out last night and slipping and sliding, but once the sun comes out, it's a little bit better. Anyway, thank you for coming. Thanks for being here. It's great to see everyone. My name is Cameron Uliott, and I'm one of the elders here at Encompass Church. Just welcome. Welcome. Thanks for being here. If you're a guest, someone who hasn't been here regularly over the last little while, one of your first times, I want to extend a special welcome to you as well. And we'd love to hear a little bit more about your experience. We'd love to hear any questions that you have, any prayer requests that you might have. And you can do that on our website, encompass.org. Yeah, www.encompass.org. church/guests. You can tell us what you thought of your visit, anything that we might need to be aware of or do a little bit better. We'd love to hear from you, so take advantage of that. Kurt Kissling is going to be continuing his study on Job. It's going to be in the kitchen, which is right through this wall. If you walk down this hallway, or not in the kitchen, it's across from the kitchen in the dining room. It's still right behind this wall. If you walk down that hallway, you can't miss it. I guess if it were in the kitchen, we might have more bacon. And I don't know. It's always good. So this class launched last week. Not too late to join. Never too late to join. Come and enjoy that teaching on the book of Job. You know, many people think that Job is a book about the proper response to suffering, but it's really a closer look at the character of God. So just after this service, down this hallway to your left in the dining room. You know, we have a couple of ministries, a couple of volunteer opportunities that are regular. We do them every so often. The Crossing is one of them. It's part of the Denver Rescue Mission, and there are about 100 people out near Stapleton. It's in Denver, but about 100 people who are in recovery for something, just needing some help. And so there's a dormitory style facility there, and Tuesday nights, oftentimes we'll take a group of 5, 6, 7 people to the Crossing in order to help serve dinner. I was fortunate enough to be able to do it this last week, and I had an absolutely wonderful time interacting with some of the folks there. There's men, but there's also families, and so it's a great outreach. It's a great opportunity. Folks who are suffering from homelessness due to self-sufficiency issues, they have Bible studies, they have counseling, they have housing, they have meals, life skills training, and we serve from about 4:45 and wrap up around 7. Oftentimes we'll meet here at church and carpool down there, meet here at 3:45. So if you're interested in doing that, I would highly recommend it first. But if you're interested in doing it, connect with Blaine Sanderson, or you can call the church office for more information on that. Christmas Eve. What day is Christmas Eve? Yeah, it's the day before Christmas. 12/24, December 24th. We're having two services here, one at 4 o'clock and one at 5:30. Now, I was told this morning that the 4 o'clock service has, well, sold out really isn't the right. It's met its capacity in terms of the reserved seating. So we will have some unreserved seating at the 4 o'clock service, maybe 20 or 30 seats. First come, first serve. So if you want a guaranteed seat, I would ask that you reserve on our website for the 5:30 service. It's going to be a great service. Kids, families, everybody is welcome. There are going to be activity packets, activity bags for the kids. Come hear the Christmas story, the story of the birth of Christ, straight from the scripture. It'll be great. So again, 5:30 is still available. Go ahead and sign up on the website. We've got a miniature golf classic coming up. This is the first ever midwinter miniature golf classic. It's going to be on Friday, January 15th. It's an event where the whole community can come. We're especially excited about having folks from outside our church come and participate in it, but we need some help. So there are going to be 18 holes, we hope. The first 9 from the Old Testament, the last 9 from the New Testament, themed holes. And so if you want to get a life group together, if you want to get your family together, maybe do one individually, that would be fine. Pick a theme, pick a Bible story, and create a miniature golf hole out of that. It'll be a great time for community, for our community, be a great time for the Encompass community as well. If you need some help with ideas, if you need some help with materials, if you have any questions about that, connect with Tom Olmos, or you can call the church office and we'll get you pointed in the right direction there as well. And then finally, our offering, if you're a member or a regular attender here at Encompass, Thank you for your generous giving. If you're a guest, your gift to us is just being here. So thank you for being here. Feel no obligation to give here today. But if you'd like to, anybody, if you'd like to go online and give via the website, encompass.church/give, we also will have some baskets here in the back if you'd like to do it the traditional old-fashioned way. So feel free to drop your offerings there. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Dear Lord, I give you this morning, from the building that we are in to the message that we will hear, I give it to you. Be with Kevin as he brings us your word. Help us as a congregation to hear it and to trust fully in it, and then go about doing it. Fill us with the joy of this Christmas season. I give you the offering received today and this week. Guide us in how best to use the resources that you have given to us to proclaim your message of hope and salvation to others for the purpose of bringing others into relationship with you. We give you all the praise and all the honor for what you have done, what you are doing, and what you will do in this place. We pray this in Christ's name. Amen.
Would you stand in this song? As we sing this together, I just wanted to mention one piece of it that says, "The hands that once split night from day, now feebly clutch a blade of hay. This is Emmanuel, majestic king, now small and weak. The word of God must learn to speak. This is Emmanuel." And it's just such a beautiful description of just him entering into our world to be with us and to fulfill his promise. So let's sing this together. On Christmas Day, a humble girl gives birth to hope for all the world. This is Emmanuel. Once split night from day, now feebly clutch the blade.
Amen.
Would you bow your heads with me? Father God, we are here to praise your name forever. Lord, we are here to adore your Son who came to save us. As we celebrate this season, the anticipation, the excitement, sometimes distracts us from the deep meaning of Jesus's arrival among us. Lord, may we see in the pages of your word the truth of why he came. May he speak to our hearts through your spirit. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. And you may be seated. I'm glad that you're here with us this morning. If I haven't met you, my name is Kevin Clark. I'm the pastor here at Encompass Church. And you might be sitting here in the room with us. You might be out in the parking lot listening over the radio. You might be watching online. We're just glad that you're here, that you've chosen to worship with us, regardless of what form of media you are worshiping with us on. Today we are going to continue a three-week series that we are calling Lineage, and we're looking at the line of Jesus. Now the story of the first Christmas is actually found in the New Testament in two books that we call the Gospels of Matthew and Luke. Matthew tells us how an angel came and told Joseph in a dream that his wife, his betrothed, Mary, was pregnant by the Holy Spirit and that she would give birth to the Messiah. He also tells us how the wise men came and visited after Jesus was born. And he tells us some things we don't often share, which are actually kind of part of the Christmas story as well, about how Joseph took Mary and Jesus to Egypt at the instigation of another angel in another dream to protect Jesus from Herod. Luke tells us some different parts of the Christmas story. He tells us the story of how Mary was met by an angel, and the angel Gabriel told her that she would carry the Christ child. And he tells us how the shepherds were in the field on the night of the birth of Jesus, and how angels spoke to them, and they were the first recipients of the message that the Messiah had been born. Luke also tells us that after Jesus was born, it was a custom to take the babies to the temple to have them dedicated, and their encounter there with Simeon and Anna, two people who had been told ahead of time that the Messiah would be arriving soon. So in those two books, we get different pictures of the first Christmas story. There's not a whole lot of overlap there, except for one thing. Both of the gospel writers actually share with us the line of Jesus. Now, they come at it from different perspectives, and so part of the two lines that they share with us are identical, but other parts are different. And as we go along in this series, I'll be explaining some of those differences and helping us to see how they fit together. But the question is, why were those two genealogies included in the Christmas story? Why are they embedded in the pages directly before and after the episodes that I just mentioned? And what do they tell us about that first Christmas? Now, last week I spent a considerable amount of time reading a very long passage, the genealogy that's found in Matthew chapter 1, verses 1 through 17, and I won't subject you to that again, but I do want to remind you of a couple of things. First of all, that genealogy in Matthew 1 begins with a summary statement. It says, "The book of the genealogy of Jesus Christ, the son of David, the son of Abraham." In the next 16 verses, 15 verses, I guess it is, we have a list of 41 names of fathers and sons, starting with Abraham and ending with Jesus. And it shows how Jesus came from both the line of Abraham and the line of David, which was important because that was promised for the Messiah. Now, Matthew also tells us something interesting in the last verse of his genealogy, which is verse 17. He says this. He says, "So all the generations from Abraham to David were 14 generations." And from David to the deportation to Babylon, 14 generations. And from the deportation to Babylon to the Christ, 14 generations. Now, if we read this carefully, we find a little bit of confusion. First of all, if you're a mathematician, you will notice that three sets of 14 add up to 42, not 41. And second, if you spent any time reading 1st and 2nd Kings and 1st and 2nd Chronicles and comparing that with the genealogy that Matthew gives us, you'll discover some names are missing. So was Matthew wrong? Now, scholars have debated this question for centuries, almost since the Gospel of Matthew was written. And some suggest that Matthew counted somebody twice. For example, in verse 17 that I just read, David is mentioned twice. Some scholars say that's how Matthew arrived at 42 generations. Others will say, well, that deportation to Babylon thing was mentioned twice, and the king who was deported was a king when he left and was not a king when he arrived in Babylon. So maybe he's getting counted twice. But if that's true, we're counting only one of the double mentions and not the other one. So that's not entirely convincing. And there are actually 15 different theories to explain where the missing generation went. I think one of the most interesting proposals is that Matthew might have been counting Tamar as the missing generation. And we talked about Tamar in length last week. In fact, in verse 3 of Matthew 1, it says, "And Judah, the father of Perez and Zerah by Tamar." Now, last week we learned that Tamar married Judah's oldest son, that he died, and then she married Onan, the second oldest son, and that he died as well. Neither of them had any children, and so she, at a convenient time later in her life, dressed herself in disguise as a prostitute and slept with her father-in-law, Judah, whose wife had died, and that he fathered her two twins. Now, I told you last week that by the laws of the Canaanite people, if that had happened, that the children who were born, the firstborn children, were not legally considered children of Judah. They were actually legally considered children of the first son who died, And so some scholars have suggested it's a possibility, and this is purely speculation, that Matthew might have counted that missing name, as that generation that brings us to 42. But even if that's true, that brings us to a second problem. There's some significant names that are missing from the line of Jesus. For example, in verse 8, it says, "And Joram was the father of Uzziah." But if you go into 2 Kings and 1 and 2 Chronicles, you find that Joram was the father of Ahaziah. Ahaziah was the father of Joash. Joash was the father of Amaziah. And Amaziah was the father of Uzziah. So what gives with that? I mean, why would Matthew select out a few names and drop them? Well, we can't be absolutely certain what Matthew's specific reason was for choosing to leave out any particular name, although there's a lot of speculation. But one thing we can be absolutely certain about is that that was actually a very common practice in the ancient world when you were writing genealogies. In fact, we see it used by the Babylonians and some of the other big empires, where kings that people knew lived and died were just completely left out. And they were left out not because the person writing the genealogy didn't know about them or that he was trying to deceive his audience. They were left out to make a specific point. Most of Matthew's original audience would be Jews who in their early childhood and young adulthood would receive religious instruction and would probably notice that certain kings were missing from the royal line. Now, they wouldn't have thought, wow, Matthew doesn't know what he's doing. He didn't do his homework. Doesn't he go to class? Doesn't he know the names of the kings? They actually would have thought, that's interesting. Why did he choose to name 14 generations in each of those sets and leave out the others? Now, the number 14 has some strong significance in the Old Testament. It's a number commonly associated at least 20 times with the idea of deliverance or salvation. One of the most overt examples is given when the Lord tells the people of Israel to observe the Passover celebration on a specific day. Now, Passover was the annual observance where they celebrated God bringing them out of Egypt, out of slavery, and delivering them. And God said, you are to celebrate the Passover on the 14th day of the first month of the Hebrew calendar. And that's only one of several references where 14 is associated with deliverance. And the Jews would know that. The Jews also, if they thought for a few moments, would realize that three sets of 14 is the same as six sets of seven. Now, I'm not trying to jump into weird numerology or anything like that, but these are numbers that pop up all the time in Hebrew writing. Now, the six sets of seven would probably remind them, at least some of them, of the 6 days of creation. That when creation occurred, it was perfect. Six sets of seven, which is the number of perfection or completion. And when Jesus appears at the end of those six sets and initiates a seventh set, it might have reminded them of the seventh day of creation when God rested. Now, the Messiah is associated with a final rest for God's people. For example, in Hebrews chapter 4, verses 9 and 10, it says, so then there remains a Sabbath rest for the people of God. For whoever has entered God's rest has also rested from his works as God did from his. So we rest when we receive the gift the Messiah gives us. We rest from our struggle to try to prove that we are inherently righteous ourselves. And we enter into that final rest that the Messiah himself is the only one who can provide. So those numbers would have flagged something in the mind of a Jewish reader, something that we don't naturally jump to immediately. So Matthew had specific reasons for naming 41, not 42, fathers and sons, for omitting some names from the line of Jesus, and probably specific reasons for grouping them into sets of 14. But Matthew also had specific reasons for naming five women. Now, I told you that was a fairly unusual practice in ancient genealogies. Women were not often named unless they had a specific role that needed to be called out, or there was a unique purpose for which they were being named. Who were the five women that Matthew named? I told you this last week. The five women were Tamar, who slept with her father-in-law and had twins, Rahab, a prostitute from the city of Jericho, Ruth, a Moabite from a people that were staunch enemies of God, Bathsheba, the woman with whom David committed adultery, and Mary, the mother of Jesus. Why would Matthew name specifically those five women? I think one of the reasons that he includes their specific mention is because each one of them has a stigma attached to them. Now, that stigma might be that she was an outsider. It might be that in the eyes of her neighbors or the rest of the Jewish world, she had been guilty of a grievous sin, or it is possible that both might be thought of as true. Yet every one of those five women wound up in the family tree of Jesus, named specifically. Now, every one of them was looking for something that the participants in the first Christmas story were also looking for. And every one of them, in her context, was used to show that God has a place and salvation even for those who stand outside the normal group we would associate with God's people. Now, last year I told you last week that we spent 4 weeks on Ruth, so I'm not going to spend any time on Ruth at all. And we're talking about Mary as we talk about the first Christmas. So we have three other names and 3 weeks in this series. Last week we talked about Tamar. Today we're going to talk about Rahab. Next week we will talk about Bathsheba. So if you have your Bible open, turn to Joshua chapter 2. Now, the people who would become the nation of Israel were released from slavery by God miraculously. You are probably familiar with that story. And at one point, they are brought through the Red Sea. They arrive in what we call the wilderness, and they come to the border of the Promised Land. Now, unfortunately, at that point, even though they've seen numerous examples of God's love and care and power, they are intimidated by the people who live in the Promised Land. They listen to reports of their stature and their ferocity, and the people as a group refuse to enter into the Promised Land. And so God says to them, you will spend 40 years walking in the wilderness until this generation, which has rejected me, dies out. Now, at the end of that 40 years, Moses had been replaced by his second in command, a man named Joshua. And the people were finally willing to cross the Jordan River and enter into the Promised Land. But their first major hurdle was a massive, double-walled pagan city called Jericho that was not far from one of the better crossings of the Jordan River. Joshua decided that they needed a little bit of reconnaissance, and so he sent two men on a secret mission. Now, it's interesting that he uses the word secret mission. Secret from probably the Israelites, not from those in the Promised Land already, but secret from those who might be fearful, and if they heard a bad report, might be inclined to try to go back. Look at Joshua chapter 2, verses 1 to 7, and it tells what happens next. It says, "And Joshua the son of Nun sent two men secretly from Shittim as spies, saying, 'Go view the land, especially Jericho.' And they went and came into the house of a prostitute whose name was Rahab, and they lodged there. And it was told to the king of Jericho, 'Behold, men of Israel have come here tonight to search out the land.' Then the king of Jericho sent to Rahab, saying, 'Bring out the men who have come to you, who entered your house, for they have come to search out all the land.' But the woman had taken the two men and hidden them. And she said, 'True, the men came to me, but I did not know where they were from. And when the gate was about to be closed at dark, the men went out. I do not know where the men went. Pursue them quickly, for you will overtake them.' But she had brought them up to the roof and hid them with the stalks of flax that she had laid in order on the roof. So the men pursued after them on the way to the Jordan as far as the fords, and the gate was shut as soon as the pursuers had gone out." So Joshua chose two men, they're not named, and he sent them to check out the land, and he says, especially Jericho. And the two spies enter Jericho, and the next verse tells us that they found lodging at the house of a prostitute named Rahab. Now, those of us who've been in church for a long time have heard this story many times. When you read through this, a lot of times at this point, you don't really think a lot about that particular unique occurrence. We kind of think of Rahab the prostitute almost as a title, like Joseph the carpenter or David the king, and we just kind of blaze right past that. But if you're hearing that story for the very first time, don't you think it would catch your attention that the first place these guys landed was the house of Rahab the prostitute? And wouldn't you think to yourself, what's going on with that? I mean, were these two young guys who were trying to have a little fun on the way? Why would they settle in that particular house? That's an odd choice. Now, just like Tamar's story last week, we have to take a step into ancient Near Eastern culture to kind of grasp why that would have been a particularly logical choice for them. Now, in the Old Testament world, the concept of hospitality was held as an extremely high valuable, or value rather. We are people who value hospitality, but not to the extent that the people of the ancient Near East did. This was an extremely high priority for them. Now, because the idea of a hotel was sort of a foreign concept, if you were traveling on the road and you came to a city around dark, you would not want to sleep on the side of the road or in the city, perhaps in an open square, because that world was dangerous. There were gangs of thieves who would perhaps come and attack you and take everything that you had, maybe even harm you or kill you. And there was probably not any semblance of a police force that you could go to receive protection. Even inside the walls of a city, it was dangerous to sleep on the streets or in an open square unless you were in a large party. So travelers very commonly out on the road at the evening time would knock on the doors of strangers and ask for lodging. Now, they might offer some kind of money or food or something like that to help pay for it, but they might just say, is there any room for me? Is there a place that I could stay? Now, in our culture today, we would probably say no if somebody who was a stranger just walked up to our front door and rang the doorbell and says, hey, can I stay in your living room tonight? Because there are alternatives, and we have live in a different cultural context, and so that would seem really strange for us. But in the ancient world, custom demanded that if you were able to provide lodging, that this was an honorable and important thing that you were meant to do. Not only that, but once your guests entered into your house, regardless of who they were and why they were passing through, they fell under your protection. Now, that creates some interesting other scenarios that we find in Scripture that helps us to understand why things happened the way that they did. Now, it's likely, though, as a known prostitute, Rahab often had strangers in her home. It doesn't say this in Scripture, but some scholars suspect that because of what says where her house is located, that she perhaps might have run a larger operation, that there might have been other women working with her, and that she might have had many guests at any given time. Now, we don't know that for sure, but it's an interesting idea to picture in our minds as we're thinking about this. So strangers in town, if they walked in and perhaps knocked on a door and said, hey, is there anywhere to stay? The people there might say, well, I know where you can stay. You can go down the street to Rahab's place. And so these men found their way there. And there were advantages to being there, especially if there were other men who were also in the building, because there was anonymity in a small crowd. And so if there were strangers from different parts of the world all gathered together, you would not stand out, and you could gather information and fly under the radar. And that may be why they found themselves knocking on the door of Rahab's house. The writers of this particular book of the Bible don't tell us why, and so we have to some extent, assume that they think we know why they would choose this place. And so there is a logic to that. But again, I'm trying to fill in the gaps, not based on what it says, but what seems like it fits. Now, the entire city of Jericho, though, in this particular moment, knew that Israel had arrived on the border. Now, we know from the censuses that were taken during that time wandering in the wilderness and when they entered into the promised land that there were somewhere in the neighborhood of 700,000 men, which means if you assume there were that many women and perhaps twice as many children, that there were probably somewhere in the neighborhood of 1.5 to 2 million people in this giant nomadic population that had just crossed the Jordan River. The dust alone would tell you they were coming. There would be no surprise, and Jericho probably had spies out in the hills watching to see what was coming next. Nobody didn't know that Israel was there, and so if strangers came into town, people would watch them very closely and want to know why they were there. So someone saw these two men and reported them to the king. And the king sent word to Rahab and said, please, well, he didn't say please, he said, send them out. Now, It's interesting, if you think about it, that the king's men didn't just storm Rahab's house and take them out by force. But if you think about that priority of hospitality, that once someone is inside of your home, they are under your protection, and the fact that that was such a cultural high value, and also the fact that Rahab, to some extent, may have been known and trusted by certain people within the city, then it makes more sense that they didn't do that, and they believed her when she said, "The men have already left." But for Rahab, this was a huge, huge risk. If she was caught harboring these men, then her life was on the line. Some 400 years probably before this story occurs, a king in Babylon, a king named Hammurabi, had a legal code written, and part of the legal code says this: if criminals are banded together in a prostitute's house and she has not hailed or reported them to the palace, that prostitute shall be put to death. So written right into the ancient Near East legal codes are cautions to people about harboring those who bring plans for destruction into a local city. Rahab's life was on the line. So when the king sent word to Rahab asking her to turn over the spies, she lies. She says they're gone. They left at sunset, but she had hidden them on the roof under some piles of flax. She tells the king's men, if you run fast, you can catch up. You'll probably find them on the road. And so they leave the city. They head east toward the Jordan River, which is where the Israelites would be, hoping to catch these two men before they make it back to their army. And the gates were closed behind them, which kept them outside, but it also trapped the spies inside. So the question is, why would a pagan and a prostitute side with the Hebrew spies and hide them on her roof? We find out when we look at verses 8 through 14. It says this: before the men lay down, she came up to them on the roof and said to the men, "I know that the Lord has given you the land, and that the fear of you has fallen upon us, and that all the inhabitants of the land melt away before you. For we have heard how the Lord dried up the water of the Red Sea before you when you came out of Egypt, and what you did to the two kings of the Amorites who were beyond the Jordan, to Sihon and Og, whom you devoted to destruction. And as soon as we heard it, our hearts melted, and there was no spirit left in any man because of you. For the Lord your God, he is God in the heavens above and on the earth beneath. Now then, please swear to me by the Lord that as I have dealt kindly with you, you also will deal kindly with my father's house, and give me a sure sign that you will save alive my father and mother, my brothers and sisters, and all who belong to them, and deliver our lives from death." And the men said to her, "Our life for yours, even to death. If you do not tell this business of ours, then when the Lord gives us the land, we will deal kindly and faithfully with you." So Rahab makes a bargain with the spies, and she begins that bargain by telling them why she's helping them. She says, "The fear of you Israelites has come upon our whole city. We are terrified. We know at least two major things that your God has done. First of all, we know that he split the Red Sea when you were coming out of Egypt, that he dried it up and made a pathway through it for you. And then when the Egyptians were pursuing you, that he let the sea come back over them and drown all of them. We also know the story of Sihon and Og." Now, these guys were two of the most powerful kings of that day. They were on the east side of the Jordan River. And Og, just to give you one example, was listed in scripture as a man who had command over 60 walled cities and numerous other small towns and villages. And he was a man of such incredible physical stature, he was referred to as one of the giants. It even describes his bed as being an iron bed that was 13 feet long and 6 feet wide. Now, I'm a big guy, but my bed's not 13 feet long. and six, well, it might be 6 feet wide, I don't know. But anyway, so these people were very intimidating, and Rahab says, we have seen what your God can do. He's not hampered by nature. He can split the sea. And he's not afraid or powerless in the face of even the greatest armies that we locally have encountered. We know we can't stand up to that power, even with our gods. So we are afraid. So the people of Jericho, Rahab included, had come face to face with who God is. Now, they had their own gods, but up until that point, nothing had ever happened to them that was really a major threat, at least to the city of Jericho. This was a pretty massive complex, and it was virtually impregnable with the kind of walls that it had. So they had never, at least in their recent past, been defeated. But after hearing and seeing the kind of things that the Hebrews' God could do, they knew that they were in trouble, and they realized how powerless their gods were. Now today, I think you and I have a lot of little gods. Now they're not gods of stone or wood or, well, maybe if they're parked in your garage they are, but stone or wood or things that people would actually physically bow down to. But there are certain gods that are unique to our culture that we worship wholeheartedly. For example, we worship comfort. The idea that we should not have to suffer. We worship control. The idea that each of us should be able to dictate the terms of our own lives and the direction our lives are headed. We worship approval, that people would respect or even love us. And we worship power. The idea that we should be able to influence those, at least those who are closest to us, to agree with and follow the same course. But in the season that we're living in right now, we're slowly but surely coming to the realization that those gods are powerless too. We've had all four things that are on the screen there that we worship taken away from us repeatedly in the last 10 months. And so like Rahab, we're left with a question. If those gods are powerless, which God will we follow? Which God can't be overwhelmed by the circumstances of our lives? And we're looking at Scripture in a fresh way and realizing that the only answer that is satisfactory is the God we find in the pages of the Old and the New Testament. So we are faced with a decision. Will I continue to cling to the gods that I've seen are powerless, that I hope someday will have a little bit more power once again? Or will I turn myself over to the God? Now, Rahab, unlike the rest of the people in her city, had reached the point where she was ready to give herself and her family to the God. So after describing how the people of Jericho, their hearts had melted and they were fearful, she says to the two spies, "For the Lord your God, he is God in the heavens above and on the earth beneath." Rahab says, "I know your God is the only God that can save us, and so I choose to trust him." And to prove her trust to the Hebrew spies, she allied herself with them by lying to the king, by hiding them, and in a moment we'll discover how she helps them to get away. Look at verses 15 through 21. It says, "Then she let them down by a rope through the window, for her house was built into the city wall, so that she lived in the wall. And she said to them, 'Go into the hills, or the pursuers will encounter you, and hide there 3 days until the pursuers have returned. Then afterward, you may go your way.' The men said to her, "We will be guiltless with respect to this oath of yours that you have made us swear. Behold, when we come into the land, you shall tie this scarlet cord in the window through which you let us down. And you shall gather into your house your father and mother, your brothers, and all your father's household. Then if anyone goes out of the doors of your house into the street, his blood shall be on his own head, and we shall be guiltless. But if a hand is laid on anyone who is with you in the house, his blood shall be on our head. But if you tell this business of ours, then we shall be guiltless with respect to your oath that you have made us swear." And Rahab said, "According to your words, so be it." Then she sent them away, and they departed, and she tied the scarlet cord in the window. So Rahab makes a pact with the men who officially represent the God of the Hebrews. And she said to them, "I know your God is the real God. He's the only one that can save us. So I am helping you. And because I'm helping you, I want you to help me. I want you to spare me, my father, my mother, my brothers, my sisters, all of their children, and all of our extended family." And so the men agree, but they agree with certain conditions. They say, "If we're going to do that, you need to tie this scarlet cord in the window so we know which house you're in, and you have to stay inside. Anyone who goes outside is effectively aligning himself with the rest of the people in the city, and they will be killed." And they also told Rahab, "The deal will be off if you slip up or intentionally tell anyone else about this agreement that we have." So she immediately lowers them out of the window and then ties the scarlet cord to the window to show her agreement with the pact that they have made. And then the next four chapters of the book of Joshua tell us how God led the people of Israel to surround the city each day, to march around it one time until the seventh day, and then to march around it seven times, and how God brought down the walls, and the people went in and destroyed everyone and everything inside the city except Rahab and her family and some precious items they were going to put into the temple. So why would Matthew include Rahab? This kind of, if you look at her story a certain way, she seems like she's a little bit maybe manipulative and sneaky, and she's making deals on the side, lying to people and covering for other people. Why would Matthew include this pagan and prostitute woman in the line of Jesus? How does her story connect with the first Christmas story? I want you to notice two things. First of all, Rahab is listed because she demonstrated unexpected faith in a God who until that moment was not her own God. Now, was it real faith or was it opportunistic? Well, if you look at the book of Hebrews chapter 11, which is often called the Hall of Faith because it lists men and women of great faith in the Old Testament, verse 31 says this about Rahab: "By faith, Rahab the prostitute did not perish with those who were disobedient, the rest of Jericho, because she had given a friendly welcome to the spies." So the inclusion of Rahab, who was a pagan and a prostitute, in the Hall of Faith and the line of Jesus tells us a couple of things. First of all, when Rahab comes face to face with the God, the real God, and the fact that her own gods were powerless against him, she puts her faith in him. You and I think are discovering in this season that there are some things we put our faith in that don't warrant that faith. And if we're going to be a person like Rahab was, then we need to remember, if I want a God with real power, I have to choose the God and put him over all other gods. We have to put our faith in the only God who can deliver no matter what the circumstances are. Second of all, I think you and I often wonder, when we look at our own lives, do I really fit the bill for a person who could become a part of God's family. Sometimes we wonder if we've made too many mistakes or committed too many sins or hurt too many people, or even doubted too much, and we question whether we can actually become a part of God's family. We feel like outsiders. Rahab was the ultimate outsider. She was from the wrong people. She was a woman, which made her, in her case, she's a leader in her family, and yet it was highly suspicious to have a woman leader in a family in that culture. Plus, she was a prostitute, which every Jew would have looked down on. If you had met Rahab before the moment that she realized who God was and started talking with the spies about her future, you would not have guessed that she would ever become a part of God's family, much less that she would become a part of the line of Jesus. Yet when the spies gave a promise, which was backed up by God's character, she trusted that his word would be true for her, just like it was true for the members of the Jewish nation. So we have to remember, whenever you and I feel like an outsider, trust that his word is true for us too. Now, in the first Christmas story, there's a small group of people who were outsiders. We call them the wise men or the magi. And we find their story in Matthew chapter 2, verses 1 through 6. If you want to flip over there, it says this. Pardon me. It says, "Now after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, in the days of Herod the king, behold, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem, saying, 'Where is he who has been born the king of the Jews? For we saw his star when it rose and have come to worship him.' When Herod the king heard this, he was troubled, and all Jerusalem with him. And assembling all the chief priests and scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Christ was to be born. They told him, 'In Bethlehem of Judea, for so it is written by the prophet, and you, O Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah. For from you shall come a ruler who will shepherd my people Israel.'" So the wise men, it says, came from the east, and they announced to Herod, who was the king of Jerusalem, although that's a stretch in the title there at the time, that they were seeking the new king. And he was alarmed, so he called all the religious experts from the Jews together to tell him who this new king was and where that new king was going to land when he arrived. And they said, "That new king will be a ruler who shepherds Israel, and he will arrive in Bethlehem." Now there's a question here. Who were the wise men? Sometimes that question puzzles us. The word that we translate wise men, the word that is often pronounced magi, comes from an ancient Persian world, and Persian word, from the part of the world that we now refer to as Iran. The word was transliterated sound by sound into Greek and became a word magoi, and in Latin it became magus, which is actually the word that we get our word magic from. But the magi were not magicians, nor were they kings, despite the song, "We three kings of Orient are." That's the last time I'm going to sing on stage. They were kind of a special class of pagan priests, almost their own tribe in Eastern cultures. And they spent their lives studying religion and also studying astrology and how events in the stars seemed to point to specific events in history. And they served as court advisors, but they were not royalty themselves. And although some of their practices were very strange, one thing that they had in common with the Jews is that they actually believed in one and only one God, and they valued good works, which was not universally true of most Eastern religions. Now, some Bible scholars think the wise men were Persian because the word magi is a Persian word, but others will say they came from Babylon, and they will point to the fact that during the captivity, the deportation to Babylon that we read in the genealogy, that people like Daniel rose to positions of power and rubbed shoulders with other wise men and probably taught them the prophecies and things that were coming in the Jewish scriptures, and that those things would be passed down from generation to generation among those wise men. And so some people think that the wise men who visited Jesus at the time of his birth might have been Babylonians too. Scripture is not specifically clear on that, so either option could be possible. These men learned the prophecy somehow, and they noticed a new star. And so they followed the star, and they arrived in Jerusalem. But they were outsiders. Just like Rahab, everyone would have looked at them and thought, who are they? They have no part among us. And you and I, if we'd been there then, would not have thought, these are men who will become followers of God, much less be used by him to tell God's story. But they were looking for a Messiah too. To them, it would be a ruler with more power than any man had ever had, a king of kings. They knew the prophecies, and so they wanted to see and meet this new king who had arrived with a star accompanying him. So when they came to Jerusalem, they created quite a stir. Herod invited them to the castle, discerned what they were looking for, said, go find the king, and then I'll follow and worship him along with you, when he really intended to take Jesus' life. But the wise men continued on to Bethlehem following the star. Look at Matthew chapter 2, verses 7 through 12. It says, then Herod summoned the wise men secretly and ascertained from them what time the star had appeared. And he sent them to Bethlehem, saying, go and search diligently for the child. And when you have found him, bring me word that I too may come and worship him. After listening to the king, they went on their way. And behold, the star that they had seen when it rose went before them until it came to rest over the place where the child was. When they saw the child, they rejoiced exceedingly with great joy. And going into the house, they saw the child with Mary, his mother, and they fell down and worshiped him. Then opening their treasures, they offered him gifts, gold and frankincense and myrrh. And being warned in a dream not to return to Herod, they departed to their own country by another way. So after meeting with Herod, the wise men followed the star to Bethlehem. And when they arrived at the house where the child was, it says they fell down and worshiped him. Now, if you ever look at a nativity scene, one of the things that, it's just like a pet peeve for me, so you just tell me to chill out. But one of the pet peeves for me is the wise men are always standing up with their gift, or they're on one knee with their gift. But that's not what it says happened in Scripture. In Scripture, it uses a word that we translate fell down. And what that means is they were on their hands and knees and they put their foreheads down to the ground in front of the child to lower themselves to a position lower than him to acknowledge his greatness and his inherent power. It wasn't just a simple gesture of, yeah, he's a king. It was an, oh my word, this is the king. This is the one that we have heard about, the one that we have looked for. I wonder what the Magi might have felt in that moment, because they traveled over 1,000 miles to arrive at Bethlehem. They knew this Messiah was promised. Did they know they were in the presence of the Son of God? Maybe. Jesus' own disciples didn't know they were in the presence of the Son of God for quite some time, so maybe not. But these wise men knew they were in the presence of a king greater than anyone they had ever seen or imagined. Greater than Herod, greater than Caesar, greater than their own king, back in Persia or Babylon, a king who would save the world, a king who in their minds must have seemed at least a little bit like a god. So the wise men got on their hands and their knees, and they surrendered themselves to that king, the child we now know as Jesus Christ. What if you and I have been looking in this season for a God with real power? What if you and I have felt ourselves at some point in the last year feeling somewhat separated from God, anxious, like an outsider, as if my life disqualifies me from a relationship with God? What are we meant to do? We are meant to do what both Rahab and the wise men who were looking for the same things we are did. Rahab surrendered herself to the God she had seen from afar. The wise men surrendered themselves to the God and King that a star and a prophecy from afar had told them was coming. You and I in this Christmas season are called, maybe for the first time, or maybe once again, to surrender ourselves to the King who is also our God. Back in the 1800s, a man now known as General William Booth founded what we call the Salvation Army. He was a Methodist preacher. He was appointed to a church in London. He felt like the people in the church never paid attention when he was teaching, and so he would go out on the street during the week, and he would preach to the poor, and he would serve them and help them out. And he got far more response from them than he ever did in his church. And so he left the church in order to found what would later become the Salvation Army. When he was in his 80s, an American evangelist named J. Wilbur Chapman happened to be visiting London and got the opportunity to come and meet with General Booth. And so he snapped that opportunity up. They had a lengthy, multi-hour conversation. And near the end of the conversation, Dr. Chapman said, "I thought to ask him a question that was on my mind." He said, "I wanted to ask him if he would disclose his secret for success." He hesitated a second, and I saw tears begin to come into his eyes and slip down his cheeks. And then he said to me, "I will tell you the secret. God has had all there was of me. There are many men with greater intelligence than me. There are many men with greater opportunities than me. But from the day I got the poor of London on my heart, and God gave me a vision of what Jesus could do with and through them, I made up my mind that God would have all of William Booth there was. And if there is anything of success in the Salvation Army today, it is because God has had all my adoration, all my will, and all the influence of my life." J. Chapman would later write of that particular meeting, "In that moment, hearing those words, I realized the greatness of a man is measured by the greatness of his surrender." Have you surrendered to Jesus Christ? Will you close your eyes? Father God, we know why your son came. He didn't come to give us a holiday that we could enjoy with lights and trees and lots of great music, but pardon me, he came to save his people from their sin. And God, in order for us to experience that, we know that we have to surrender to you. We have to acknowledge that we are sinners, that there is no inherent goodness or righteousness in us, but that you offer goodness and righteousness through your Son, who was completely and fully surrendered and obedient to you in every way and never sinned himself, who died on the cross as a sacrificial lamb who paid the price for all of our sin. And so, Lord, in this moment, we ask you to remind us, maybe for the first time or maybe for the millionth time, of how deeply significant his arrival, even as a baby, was to our future, to the fact that we could have a relationship with you where one was not available to us previously. We are so grateful for his arrival. We are so grateful for his life and what he has done. Lord, if there's anybody in this room, I do ask, if there's anyone in this room who has not put his or her faith in you, I pray that at this moment, your spirit would begin to work on their hearts if you're not already doing that, and that you would draw them into a solid and undeniable realization that they need you and you alone to have that relationship. Lord, bring them to the place where they acknowledge that they are sinners. And Lord, lead them to the moment where they can say to you, God, I can't save myself. Save me through your Son. Lord, draw anyone who doesn't know you into that relationship for the first time. And for those of us who are already there, Lord, this has been a rough season. You know that. You know our hearts. We're tempted sometimes to forget just how powerful you are, just how open you are even to the outsider, that you are a God of love, of mercy, and of grace. Lord, remind us of that. We ask these things in Jesus' name. We pray all of this. Amen. Would you stand with us and we'll sing our last song together.
Messiah, baby boy, to save us all.
Thank you for being here with us today. I love that we ended that song with "On Our Knees We Fall," just like the wise men. So could you throw up, you're down here now. I keep looking up in the corner. You guys are all down here. Could you throw up this slide? Oh, it's up there. So if you have any questions about what I shared at the end of this message and you're wondering, have I ever surrendered to Jesus? I would love to talk with you personally. You can come grab me anytime you see me, but you can also get a hold of me several ways that are listed on the screen up there. And that text number actually comes directly to me. So if you want to start there, that would be a great place to start. Let me close this in a word of prayer, and then we'll go out and enjoy another week of the Christmas season. Father God, thank you for the blessing of being able to celebrate your son. As we go into this week, Lord, with all the busyness of scrambling to do the last shopping and planning and trying to figure out where we're going to celebrate Christmas and all those kinds of things, Lord, we pray for a sense of peace that comes from knowing that you are the God of real power, that you are the God who has a place for us in your family, no matter how far outside of that we might sometimes feel. Lord, help us to surrender wholeheartedly to you each and every day. We ask these things in the name of your precious son, whom we celebrate. Amen. Have a great week, and we'll see you soon.